What's good, guys? So today we're watching 10 Things Only Americans Do and Think It's Normal. And yeah, let's watch.
If you don't like America, why don't you get out?
I love
Welcome to
America.
Watch Mojo. And today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 things Americans do that the rest of the world doesn't.
You're 15, right?
Yeah,
I gotta call your parents.
It's time. It's time.
Don't wait another minute for Claritin.
Do you do it every day?
Yeah.
For this list, we're going over the things that are more common in the United States of America than in most other countries. While some of them are present elsewhere, they're not quite as widespread as in the U.S. And no judgment. This is supposed to be a lighthearted list after all, so keep a sense of humor and know that it's all in good fun. If there's a particular Americanism that our list didn't cover, please do tell us in the comments. Number 10. Refer to the USA as America.
America. I just love the word, man. USA feels like you're trying to be a genius.
Outside of the United States of America, referring to the country as America is much less commonplace. After all, there are two entire continents called America, comprising like 35 what? Distinct nations. Referring to
No, but South America doesn't really count. I think they should rename it to something else, like Fake America or something. All the good stuff takes part in North America. South America, eh.
Only one country on one of those continents as America too is really confusing for anyone who doesn't live there.
From this day forward, it's going to be only America first. America first.
Calling it
Man,
the
I
US,
love
USA, the United States, or just the States is much more common in the rest of the world. Even so,
That's
everyone
so
still
uncommon.
Calls its residents Americans, which isn't confusing at all.
You can't say it, but you know it's true.
Number 9. Have pharmacies that
have
sell
pharmacies.
Groceries. In most of the world, pharmacies sell exactly what their name implies, pharmaceuticals. While you will see tangentially related items like grooming products or hygienic things like toothbrushes, pharmacies don't usually carry food or toys. But in the US, that's much more common. The country
CVS
is all about the
like...
all-in-one experience. Not only will dedicated grocery stores have pharmacies built in, but pharmacies will also carry groceries. Granted, the selection isn't always great.
That's normal,
but if you're
right?
desperate for milk and the grocery store is closed or you just don't feel like crossing the street to get there, you can get some. While most...
I mean, I wouldn't really complain even if I was in the UK. Because, you know, bunching things together is so cool, bro. Like a pharmacy. It'd just be so bland if it was just some guy pretending to be a doctor and... he has medicine, but when there's foods and all that, it feels like home. It feels great. It doesn't feel like a scary hospital.
It still limits drugstores to drugs and self-care products.
But they should sell more drugs like cocaine at
Number
pharmacies.
Eight,
they don't really sell any good
drink.
Stuff.
Worldwide, the age at which a person can legally drink alcohol is most commonly 18. The age usually considered to be adulthood, though it is even earlier in some countries. The voting age on a global scale is also generally 18, for similar reasons, although of course there are exceptions.
The Voting Rights Act of 1970 lowered the voting age to 18 for national elections, and the 26th Amendment made the change to 18 permanent for all elections.
And 18 is where it has stayed for the past 50 years.
However, the United States requires young adults to wait 3 years after being able to vote before legally being allowed to drink at 21.
Yeah, but
this
drinking
was enacted
isn't
during
even
the 1980s
fun, so.
To prevent alcohol-related driving accidents.
This law has been an abysmal failure. It hasn't reduced or eliminated drinking. It has simply driven it underground, behind closed doors, into the most risky and least...
Oh, man, if I tell you, boy, I had this friend named... I think Catalyst, was that his name? I don't know, something like that. This guy was 14 or 13. This guy loved drinking, man. I think he had a drinking problem. That's the disease he had. He used to drink so much. His parents were so careless. They'd buy a bunch of beer and leave it in the fridge, and this guy would take some to school. It was nice. He never got caught. To this day, he still drinks, so... all these rules that you hear, 18 to drink, it's all fake. there's so many drinks at underage parties, man. It's insane. So I guess on paper it shows that, oh, 18 drink, I mean 21 drinking age, but you know, real life, when you're in all those parties, it's cool. All these kids are drinking and they don't even care. But I wouldn't really care either. I'd probably help a kid smuggle drinks into the
manageable
party.
A setting.
While it helped in the short term, ultimately it hasn't really stopped teenagers from drinking. The result is
Never.
That many people, both inside and outside the U.S., question the logic of why an 18-year-old American can decide who forms the government but not get buzzed.
The reality is everyone drinks before they turn 21. That's why when you go out for your first legal drink, you have to react with that faux surprise like you've never heard of alcohol before.
I'll probably never drink
what
alcohol,
what does this
man.
Alcohol taste like?
I'd say I'd rather try cocaine before
alcohol.
Ooh,
this is true.
Number seven.
Why?
Tip service personnel.
All right, everybody cough up some green for the little lady. Come on, throw in a buck.
Uh-uh, I don't tip.
You don't tip?
No, I don't believe in it.
While the concept of tipping waitstaff or other people in the service industry is known worldwide, few countries have embraced the concept to the degree the U.S. has.
Labor movements declare the practice undemocratic, and anti-tipping legislation was enacted across several states. But restaurants and rail operators like the Pullman Company embraced tipping because it allowed them, among other things, to hire recently freed slaves without having to pay them.
Many workers, particularly in the restaurant industry, rely on gratuities to get by, in part because laws allow managers to pay sub-minimum wages to tipped workers. However, in various other countries, tipping is seen as insulting.
Whoa, tipping is seen as insulting? Nah, I don't know. Come on, you guys should chill with that. I feel like if a manager paid me less because someone tipped me, yeah, we're going to fight. We're going to have to fight for that because... You know, it feels greedy. This person, I know it's their job to work there and all that, but this person is just doing everything perfect. They're just doing everything. And, you know, why not leave a dollar or two? That's not really too much to ask for, especially if you're this hungry pig, you have all these foods on the table and you're just eating food after food, requesting meal after meal. This person is coming to take care of you. You won't leave a dollar or two, bro? I mean, I guess you don't have to tip because that's their job, but you know, I guess sometimes you feel sorry for them, you know, tell them keep the change. I'd like that tip. Especially DoorDash
just
drivers.
Doing their jobs, after all.
Each year, Americans spend $40 billion on tips.
Billion?
That's more than we spend on foreign aid and more than we spend on gambling. And like gambling, it's not entirely clear that tipping makes any sense in the first place.
While some countries' workers certainly appreciate it, it isn't expected like it is in the U.S. Mostly because employees are paid a high enough baseline salary that they don't need tips to survive.
Restaurant owners still pay their servers less than minimum wage, turning what used to be a bribe into an obligation that makes the end of every meal suck.
Number six, obsess over the military.
And I think I speak for the rest of the WWE. I certainly speak for myself. I would like to say thank you to all our men and women who choose to don the uniform of the United States military.
The American military is probably the best in the world, as it should be, since it's also one of the best-funded militaries in the world. In fact, the U.S. spends several times more on their military than their nearest competitor, China. What's more, there are more than a few American citizens who have a higher-than-average fascination with their own military and its culture.
I thank you as your commander-in-chief because you inspire me. Your willingness to serve, to step forward, at a time of war and say, send me, is the reason the United States stays strong and free.
While other countries certainly appreciate their troops, you don't, say, see as many people wearing camouflage as a legitimate fashion statement. Likewise,
I really don't think anyone obsesses over this stuff, though. I don't know. Yeah, I think everybody's afraid to die, bro. No one wants to go with the military like that. But then it's really not... I don't think you really die in the military. I don't think they send you to the hottest part of the battle. immediately like that. It kind of gives me, I kind of question what those military guys do. I know they're serving our country and all that, but I see these TikToks of these guys chilling and they're like, yeah, military work. You know, military work. These guys are just standing around on base, I guess. That's all they're doing. So we're, the fighting part, there's not much war going on, I guess.
Movies made elsewhere that glorify the military to the degree that the U.S. does.
Do me a favor. Tell my children.
But hey, gotta love America.
I love them very much. All right, you alien assholes. In the words of my generation, up yours!
Of the American enthusiasm is certainly rooted in patriotism. Still, it may
they
also
hate police,
be a reaction
bro.
To an
they really hate
anti-military
police.
Sentiment that has popped up over the last several decades.
No war, okay? No war, okay? Oh, well, here you go, okay. Boys. This will help you protest. It's good to see that you care about peace, boys, okay?
Number 5. Work too much. Americans are workaholics, at least compared to basically every other country in the world. The majority of Americans work more than 40 hours a week.
Why do we do this to ourselves? Well, the conventional answer is that this attitude towards work makes the American economy the envy of the world. America is a hectic, turbocharged system that builds, destroys, rebuilds all at warp speed.
They also tend to lack many of the things the rest of the world takes for granted, like paid holidays, as well as sick and parental leave. Research has shown that happier, less stressed workers do better at their jobs. Iceland even recently tried
Man, I really don't care that much about that stuff, but are you making money? That's the big question. If you're not making more money than me, I'm stress-free, I'm happy. Yeah, because what's a week of vacation gonna do for me? I'm gonna call in like, yo, I actually wanna work these few weeks you gave me again. Yeah, because what's the family gonna be eating if I come back home and use that paid leave? Because they trust me, I have a teacher, they get paid leave if they want, but it's just the work is not that difficult that they need to take that paid leave, which, you know, I don't mind. If my job was like a construction guy, I'd probably take paid leave because, you know, it's a toll on your body. But if my job is easy, I'm just sitting on a desk, I'm gonna come to work every day. unless my kid is gonna get circumcised or something like that. Aside from that, coming home.
4-day work week that proved wildly successful.
There's lots of other benefits to a 4-day working week. It's not just the environment, you know, it's not just the mental health and economy, you know, good for the economy. It's also environmental benefits too. You know, evidence looks like when we're commuting less as a result of a 4-day week, that brings down emissions. Also, energy consumption goes down. So this is...
Yo, why does UK have so many accents? I just never understood that part. Like, it's literally not that far from each other. It's the size of Texas, bro. 63 million people total. I understand why America has all these different accents, but the UK... Bro, there's Scotland, Ireland, and England and Wales, or whatever part that is. But yeah, just use the same accent, bro. You're not that, you're like 30 minutes from each other. You can use the same accent. I think it's just for attention. They just want some attention too, or they're copying someone.
And for the environment, for workers, for employers, what's not to like about it?
Several European countries take long breaks for lunch. While the American drive is admirable,
30 minutes,
grind culture
bro.
Becomes
30.
Problematic when it costs workers their mental health and well-being. Number 4, put sales tax on everything.
Sales tax is paid when you buy something, and the business you purchased your goods from sends that money to the government.
Yeah, bro, imagine
there
I had to pay that stuff for cocaine.
Tax.
It's crazy.
General sales tax and excise taxes. General sales tax is a tax levied on most goods you buy. Excise taxes are taxes levied only on certain items.
Most countries enact a value-added tax, or VAT, on goods or services purchased within their borders. These taxes are collected from every person in the supply chain, from the distributors to the consumers. The United States is one of the few to use sales tax, which not only vary wildly from state to state, but are only enacted after a purchase has been made.
The state treasury depends on sales taxes to pay for road repairs, education, and medical care for children, seniors, and the poor.
They're also not listed in the initial price, which can leave foreign visitors and many Americans scratching their head as to why they're being charged.
I've had it with these sales tax, bro. They piss me off. I'm at the store. I buy, you know, like, okay, let's say a cookie or a banana, and they're asking me, yeah, you'll need 10 more cents. I brought the dollar, bro, the dollar that says the prices, and they're asking, yeah, 10 cents more. And I know I'm looking at this cashier. I'm like, bro, you're not going to embarrass me in front of the line, bro. The line's back. You're not going to embarrass me. Like, let me go, because you just take the bill. I really don't go with anything extra. If I know it costs a dollar, it should be a dollar. And some of those cashiers, bro, they don't have hearts. They look at you, they're like, yeah, 10 cents. You're like, come on, man, forgive me. It's 10 cents, bro.
Product, better or worse, you decide. It's certainly more confusing.
What's the advice then? If you're gonna buy a big ticket item, where is the cheapest sales tax?
Well, you know, you can go online and look at all the sales tax rates for different cities. And if you look at one dealership or one, you know, Best Buy or something like that, you can find the different zip codes and look at the sales tax rates and just see how much that'll little take off, and then take your family out for a nice night.
There you go.
Number three, the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag
what is
of
that,
the United States of America.
Many parts of the United States, school children,
we barely do it anymore,
in some settings,
though,
are expected to recite the Pledge of Allegiance. This is an expression that they will be loyal to the USA and is usually performed daily while looking at the nation's flag.
But back then, in 1892, when it was written by Francis Bellamy, Bellamy was a Baptist minister, and in conjunction with a magazine called The Youth's Companion, he wrote this, at that time, 23-word Pledge of Allegiance.
Citizens of other countries might respect or salute their flag and country, but a daily affirmation? Not in most places. The Pledge of Allegiance,
I think
that,
that's what makes America so great. I feel like if I was tasked with creating this pledge, I'd make it more like a song almost. Because that Star Spangled Banner, that national American song, that hits, that's beautiful. But this pledge, we never stood up in class, really. The teacher said, if you want to stand up, you can. If you don't have to.
Controversy and criticism, both from outside the U.S. and from within. Some see it as indoctrination. Others find its mentions of God problematic. And still others think it was simply written to sell merch. Whatever the case,
merch
is not a common thing in the rest of the world.
But the bottom line is, we all look different, sound different, but we are all on the same team.
Number two, go bankrupt from healthcare. Medical costs are the cause of over 60% of all bankruptcies in the United States.
In 2017, one-third of the money raised on GoFundMe went towards medical campaigns. And the
That's true. I see these people. You know, every time I see someone died or someone at a funeral, I see GoFundMe. I guess it's mandatory because, you know, some people don't have enough to pay for a funeral. How much does a funeral cost? Because I feel like I'd be scared of being burnt. Like, nah, being burnt is crazy. Yeah, that's not the ideal. I know you're dead and you won't feel the burns, but you can't burn me like that, bro. Like, come on, bro, that's just burning. That's wild. That's deep. That's, I feel that deeply on another level. But then you won't leave any smelly flesh. That's kind of the positives. I feel like I would want to go, I would want to get transported back to my home country to get buried there. I feel like not a lot of people get the, wait, a lot of people actually do that. What am I talking about? But you got to be rich though. I'm not a big fan of healthcare. How many times do you even get sick per year? Not that much, bro. Unless you have autism or ongoing medical issues. I don't think you should get that healthcare deal. It's costly, I'm telling you. And all you get diseased with is like a headache. I don't know if diseased was the right word.
Raises $650 million a year for more than 250,000 medical campaigns.
Americans experience a variety of unexpected charges while getting much needed care. From surprise bills to being charged for riding in an ambulance.
According to one study, 71% of all ambulance providers do not take the patient's insurance. That same study found that 79% of patients who took an ambulance could get a surprise bill, with an average total around $450.
In some parts of the civilized world,
it costs way more than $450,
bro. A medical bill can be an uncommon occurrence. Healthcare worldwide tends to be much more regulated than it is in the U.S. It's either funded through taxes in a single-payer system or else through individual insurers who are more strictly monitored.
Other countries, they don't have this problem. Instead of every private insurance company negotiating with every healthcare provider, there's just this big list. Country, the central government, they go and they say, if you want to sell to us, to all of our people, then here's what you can charge for a checkup. Here's what you can charge for an MRI or a prescription for Lipitor.
Bottom line, while there can sometimes be extra charges, for most of the world, medical debt is basically unheard of, except in horror stories about the U.S.
Can't get a credit card.
Interesting.
I can't buy a house. I don't see me ever being out of debt.
Before we get to our top pick, here are some honorable mentions. Free refills. Restaurants will fill up glasses with even more drinks for free and with
this
lots of ice.
This is beautiful. Mm-hmm. I always get that refill. I love lemonade. That's my favorite drink
Roll
to refill.
Baby showers. Many cultures see them as bad luck or in poor taste.
Really? Oh, that's kind of funny. Yo, what about an intersex baby? What happens for that baby shower? Do they throw both red and pink up when that happens? I've always wondered. But then you don't really hear about intersex babies a lot because those things are just things at that point. They don't even exist anymore, I think. I think they cured that disease, right? I hope so, or else I'm gonna have to step up and be a doctor.
Wear shoes indoors. Sure, not every American does this, but
it's I have mine so
weird
right
in a lot of countries.
My floor is wood, so.
Advertise drugs to consumers. Pharmaceutical companies' clout allows this.
Yeah, I see heroin being advertised a lot.
These ads are legal in most countries, but in the US, they're everywhere. On average, 80 of them air every hour on American television.
Ask your doctor.
Ask your doctor.
My doctor told me.
Use red plastic cups for alcohol. Who decided on these
always
for every American party?
Here we go.
I mean, what are you going to use then? What would you use instead?
Before we continue, be sure to subscribe to our channel and ring the bell to get notified about our latest videos. You have the option to be notified for occasional videos or all of them. If you're on your phone, make sure you go into your settings and switch on notifications.
We get it.
Number one, use the Imperial Measurement System.
Can you?
What the hell is that?
Yes.
How the country that can send men and hopefully women to the moon.
Yeah, all and beyond.
Still are in gallons and inches.
Mm.
And when the entire world is metric, I do not understand it.
There are three countries in the world that don't.
That's embarrassing. You guys are really using that, the metric system, as number one? That is BS, bro. I don't even use numbers anymore. I use Siri. Gallons, pounds, all that good stuff. That's what you're supposed to use, bro. That's the normal stuff. I hear someone telling me, yeah, I'm 185 centimeters tall. Like, dude, use feet. That's the normal way. I feel like the whole world is weird compared to America. They just try to project their insecurities on us, you know?
Use the metric system. Myanmar, Liberia, and the United States. Objectively, metric is the less arbitrary measurement system, since everything goes by tens. Even Britain and Commonwealth countries have converted.
The point is, the US system has always been a little more accessible than metric. Sure, stacking up 12 thumb widths to make a foot, that's still kind of weird, but it's not so weird that we're clamoring to change it.
Although, admittedly, they do still use measurements like feet and inches casually.
So now I can't ask a distance when I visit another country. I'm like, how far is that? They're like, that's 500 kilometers. I'm not in the Olympics.
So why hasn't the U.S. converted? We'll give you one guess. Did you say it's because of money? Because money is definitely a big factor. Converting to a whole new system of measurement is expensive. Other factors include a need for control and stability of the U.S. So inertia, basically. Why change when you don't need to? And you know what your mom says. If all the other countries jumped off a bridge, would the U.S. do it too? or something like that.
No.
A 2015 Rasmussen poll asked Americans if we should switch to the metric system and adopt Celsius as our main temperature scale. 64% said no, while...
No, I would leave this country if they made Celsius the regular thing. Celsius, bro, that sounds like you're trying to be some nerd. It's 30 Celsius outside, man. I love Fahrenheit. I'm in love with that system. I love that stuff. No, man. Metric system is for nerds.
21% said yes, and the remaining 15% was undecided. So it looks like we're perfectly fine with being different.
We are. We're really fine.
Check out the...
For the most part, I don't know. But yeah, have a nice day.